Hello everyone. Today I will talk about how I'll talk about password security with my mom, her boss, and John Doe. These are feedbacks on some of my awareness talks about password security I've been doing for the last few years. So before starting this talk, I want just to tell you a small story that happened to me and a friend on Sunday after well, on Sunday we've been drinking some beers with some people here, and on our way back to our hotel, we crossed the road where the red light was on for the pedestrians. I'm French, so in France it's not really an issue to cross when it's red. Well, we knew it wasn't really right to cross the road where it was red, but we didn't know it was forbidden here, and what should have happened, happened. So a police car showed up. And the first policeman tried to explain us why it was bad to cross at the red light. And the second one wanted to punish us and to give us a fine of €5 or something like this, because it's really forbidden here to cross on the red light. So we've learned it the hard way. And in fact, it can be related to passwords, because passwords, as traffic lights, are really part of our lives. In the real world, passwords are everywhere. You use them every day. You don't even notice you are using them everywhere and at every time. Most people feel that they are doing it wrong, feel that their password policy is not the greatest of the password policies in the world. But they just do it until they have to face reality, because their usernames, their passwords are in the data leak, and their identity might have been saved, or they might face other problems. One of the issues here is that people receive too much information. They have the information about leaks everywhere, the information about passwords being a real danger for your security online. They receive the information that hackers can crack everything and that no one is safe. So they are resigned after some time. And one thing to note is that that complex and unique passwords are really not suited for human beings. If you have to remember 20, 30 passwords, one for a website, and 10, 15 characters long website, it's not really designed for humans. Sorry. In a nutshell, who am I and motivations? I've been password cracking stuff since 2012, mostly for fun and also for scaring myself each time I launch simple dictionaries and some data leaks. I've been a member of Team Hashcat for the last few years. I'm also a staff on Zinc Security, which is a French InfoSec community, and also a student at Telecom Suite Paris, who I'd like to thank, because I wouldn't be here tonight if I wasn't a student here, there. And most importantly, I've been giving password awareness talks to John and Jane Doos, IT staff, or other people for the last few years. Can you hear me correctly at the back, or do I have to speak louder? Good, okay. So, warning and disclaimers. I'm French, I have a shitty accent, as you've probably noticed, so sorry. I do not like having my face online, so as we said earlier, try to avoid taking pictures of my face. I'm not toy hunt, so my slide won't contain any holidays pics, or pics of the sea or the sun or anything like this. Sorry. And so this is the most important disclaimer. This is only based on my personal feedbacks of my awareness talks. Results may vary. It depends on who you are facing. It depends on who you have seen. And yeah, there are no real statistics on the slides. Sorry. And I really like the talk of this morning about password use. Kudos to the one who did this. Kudos. So, agenda. In first part, I will talk about some communication difficulties for some group of people, like John Jane Doe's, developers, sysadmins, CISO, or deciders. In the second point, I will review some of the key points I tried to share with the people during awareness talks. It won't be rocket science. Disclaimer also. That's a methodology. And in the last part, I want to get back on some do's and don'ts of awareness talks. Some mistakes I've made and I've seen, and that are really bad if you want to really transmit some values and some ideas to Jane Doe's, in fact. So, communication difficulties. John and Jane Doe's, they have no to low technical culture. You have to know that. They hate complexity. They want simple things. Most importantly, they hate math. Sorry. They have heard of Snowden and with some recent leaks. They know some things about passwords are not really safe or something like this. But they just know it, like we knew it wasn't good to cross at the red light. Most importantly, as the Dashlane studies have shown, shown this 2 weeks ago, 4 in 10 Americans will sacrifice sex for 1 year if it means they never had to worry about being hacked, having their identity stolen or their accounts breached. So a sacrifice of 1 year of sex, sorry. People really want to move on and really want to have better security online. It's not something that people don't want or something people are not aware of. They're aware of the problem and they want to get on this. Most importantly, they have priorities. They want to secure their emails, they want to secure their banking stuff. Some gaming websites, they use one-time permits. They're aware that if the password for this website is not really good, it's not really a problem, but they have priorities. So you have to use those priorities. And the SWOT model is mostly general attacks. They aren't really focused by really targeted attacks. Most people are only victims of mass scanning, mass attacks by script kiddies, but not really by really targeted attacks. Unlike this other group of developers and system administrators. This group of people have medium to good technical culture. They can accept some complexity because it's their work. They still hate math, sorry. Sysadmins, they have to secure access to information systems, so they have a huge responsibility due to this mission. Developers, most of them want to know how to store passwords securely. In fact, most developers have heard of MD5 and are already using MD5, and some people told them that there's a better thing that is called SHA-1. It's longer, so it might be better. And in some time, in a year or two, they might replace MD5 with SHA-1, but it's a plan. So why not? The SWOT model for those users are really targeted attacks because mostly for sysadmins, they have access to a lot of information. And if I remember correctly, a few years ago the French online hoster OVH had one of his network compromised because one of their network administrator was targeted by an attack, and they get access to his emails, and then they get to some VPN keys, and then they get access to an internal network. So developers and sysadmins are really critical looking at the SWOT model. And the third and last group of people, CISO and deciders. They have very varying tech culture, from none to quite good. They might accept complexity also, but they still hate maths. Cliché, they have set a password policy because they've seen one in their previous job, or they've read somewhere that it was good to have a password policy. So they also put a 30-day renewal policy. And very complex password composition. So users hate the Caesar and deciders, and they use password December 16 to bypass the restrictions. As we've seen, these three different group of people have, in fact, why they are really different. They have some common like of cultures, they have some common acceptance, and they also all want to change something. Maybe not CISO and deciders, but most of them want to move on and to have new ideas to secure themselves. So when you go do an awareness talk somewhere and you face this kind of audience, it's really good to see that most of them want to hear something new, to hear something that will help them or that might help their users. And in fact, that's how I designed my awareness talks afterwards, by giving them key points, by answering questions they have about how stored passwords, how those passwords attacked by hackers, how can they be cracked, and how can they defend themselves. So that's the key points I will tell you now, after I drink some water, because, you know. OK. So first of all, generalities. How are passwords stored? This is a question I get a lot of time from John Doe's and Jane Doe's, because they know that if passwords were in plain text everywhere, something would be wrong. You know, the systems administrators, developers would have access to all the passwords, so there would be a really important privacy issue here. And they also want to know why. Why are the password hashed? So this is for privacy and in case of a leak. But when they know this, so they have to know the difference between online and offline attacks. Because you know there is a great difference between those two kind of attacks. And you have to give your audience, your John and Jane Doe's, the idea that online and offline attacks, which were really different a few years ago, are now joining back together. A basic online attack is really slow, at most some like tens candidates per second, or some tens of candidates, and they're easily detected by websites. In fact, if you try to use IDWA, which is an online password cracker on Facebook, you will get banned after three or four twice. On some websites, you won't be banned, but you will be really limited on the number of attempts you will be able to do per second. So it's slow, it's easily detected. Most of the time, an attacker will use a top 100 passwords watch list, or if it's a targeted attack, a specific code list, like with names of the pets, family, et cetera. Whereas in an offline attack, it can be really, really fast. The company Sagita HPC has built clusters that do over 6 tera candidates per second on NTLM. NTLM is a kind of hash used on Windows, for instance. So 6 tera candidates per second, it means 6,000 billion candidates per second. It's really, really huge. With this, you can crack 10 characters long with every choice that you want in really a few hours, I think. I didn't do the math. And also, there are tons and tons of data nowadays, thanks to the leaked talk about leaks. We've seen this morning that there are 5 million credentials per month that are leaked. The most important leaks nowadays, like MySpace with 350 million users, or Yahoo with 800 million users, contains a lot of passwords. And in fact, those passwords can be used to optimize targeted attacks due to password reuse. And this is something that we are really seeing nowadays. So the online and offline attacks are joining back together. And we see here that password reuse is really, really a big issue. So key points and methodology about attackers' method to attack passwords. The goal of an attacker is to crack the password at the lowest cost possible. So this means using dictionaries, using word lists that targets password reuse, because you will have already known password in your word list. This also means using mongling rules to insert dates, strings in the password you have in the word list, toggling keys, substitute characters to crack passwords that use LitSpeak, for instance. An attacker has a lot of different methods to optimize his attacks. Sorry for the pass quacker out there. It's not a workshop about pass quacking. I will stay on the simple stuff. Another kind of attack you've heard of is brute force attack. Brute force means exhaustive search. So you will try every combination, every possibility in a given char set and length. But it's slow as hell with long passwords. So hackers have come in a way to optimize this using masked attack, like in Hashcat. This can be really useful to bust patterns, to crack passwords that follow patterns like uppercase, some lower cases, digits, and special characters. And there is also another optimization using probability that is on par default on Hashcat, if I remember correctly. Yeah. That is to use a Markov model, or per position Markov model on Hashcat. That's it. Yeah. Try the candidates that have the best possibility of existing first and the least possibility at the end to crack more passwords in less time. And most importantly, attackers analyze the passwords they crack to gather statistics on length, on char sets, and patterns. And this is used to create new set of specific mongling rules, new set of masks, to crack more passwords that follow the same patterns. And in fact, similar passwords, thanks to the analysis and thanks to mongling rules, will be cracked. And using this, we can crack really long passwords that use patterns. So from the user side, when you see this, you are starting to say, OK, so if your password is reused somewhere, you are doomed. If it's not long enough, you are doomed. If it contains pattern, you are doomed. Yes, and it's worse, because if your website has a restrictive password policies, this will create even more patterns. So it will, in fact, make the game easier for the pass cracker. So when you know this, when you see that the attacker will find many ways to optimize his attacks to crack more passwords and in less time, what are your weapons on the defender side, on the user side, on the developer side? Well, for users, during my Renaissance talks, I talk about multi-factor. Because they have heard something about this in some media, in some newspaper, but they don't really know what it is. So what I am, biometric, I'll tell them about the things that biometric is mostly probabilistic, and that there is an issue if there is a leak for biometric data, because I only have 10 fingers. So how can I revoke my fingers? I won't cut them. It's really problematic. Another thing is that I also talk about the conference some guys at the CCC did a few years ago about how they get the fingerprints from pictures. And I have 10 fingers, but now I don't have them anymore if someone has taken some pictures. So what I have, YubiKeys, RSA Secure ID. For me, what I have is something that most people could have with them, like Google Authenticator or some authentication scheme we have seen on mobile phones yesterday, if I remember correctly. This is something good. And yeah, it also has some flaws, but people are not really, most people will gain a substantive level of security by using this kind of stuff. And what I know, which are passwords. I'll tell people to use multi-factor auth if they can, because it's really easy to use nowadays. Like for Google's multi-factor authentication, you have to enroll yourself on one device only once, to authenticate yourself on a device only once. And he won't ask you again at each time you connect if something hasn't changed. And this is good, because it's simple for the user to get into this. But on the, more importantly, about the passwords, the two golden rules I give to people is to not reuse their passwords and not use simple passwords. Because if we remember correctly, most people, most John and Jane Doe's, will not be targeted. Most of the time, they will be just victims of script kiddies, of automatic attacks, and they just need to use a not too easy password and not to reuse them this password across websites. Another thing is, if your neighbor can guess your password, something is wrong, is you use your pet name. I've put that after. Your pet name or something like this in your password, yeah, it can be guessable if you are with a non-technical targeted attack. Most importantly, use password manager. They will use users' usage of authentication, of password authentication, and they will also, this will also raise the level of security, online security. And also stay aware. Tell your users to register to leak awareness websites like Have I Been Pwned Yet by Twyant, because how can you know when your data is at risk? How can you know to when you have to change your passwords? This is really something interesting, and they have to register on this kind of websites. It's only a one-time registration, and it will give them information each time there is a leak. On the developer side, I tell them to not use MD5, SHA-1, or other raw hash functions because they are too fast and the cost to the attacker is really low. In fact, I also tell them to use paper and use salts. Who are familiar with salts and paper here? OK. Not in the kitchen. OK. Salts are pair user strings that are concatenated with their passwords before being hashed. So as an attacker, if you have to crack a leak with salts, so you have to check each password and each salt when you run the attack. So if you have 1,000 salts, it will slow down your attack by 1,000. On the other hand, paper is a string that is not per user, but per site, and that is not stored in the database. Salts are stored in database alongside user's password hash and user's data. Paper should be stored in a file separated on config file, but not in database. The paper is also concatenated with the password of the user. So as an attacker, if you have to crack a hash where there was a paper that was concatenated with the user password, you have to first discover the paper, and then you can start cracking really the hashes. But most of the time, since leaks are only database dumps, you won't find the paper in the leaks. I think it's the Tumblr leaks, which contained, we think, a paper, and no one has cracked this paper for the moment. Just look out, a paper is not cryptographic function. Adobe's leak was crypted using 3DRS, but once someone finds the key, he can decrypt everything. If someone finds a paper, you still have to crack the passwords afterwards. So thoughts and paper are complementary. Also, like everything that is related to crypto, do not do your own magic stuff on your side. There are already well-defined functions like bcrypt that can be used easily. Maybe in a few years, this recommendation will move on to Argon 2. But for now, I stay with bcrypt. So, C0 deciders. Most password policies suck. Users try to bypass them by using simpler passwords, and the more restrictive your policy is, the simpler the patterns that the user will use. The simpler the patterns. So most of the time, if you have a huge policy with uppercase, lowercase, special and digits, the user will just put uppers and lowercase, some special and digits, or digits then specials. It's 50-50. If you have first numerals, people will open the months or counter at the end. In fact, NIST and Microsoft have released guidelines against this policy. Well, NIST is a draft of the guidelines for authentication. But Microsoft has released some paper in July about this also. So policies are really a bad thing. And in fact, I had some feedbacks a few months ago from a guy who said that in his company, they had a very restrictive policy. And at some point, they knew that something was wrong, so they got rid of the policy, and they started to do a monthly check of users' passwords by trying to crack them, and to give some awareness talks to the users. And in fact, after 2 or 3 months, they started to have really hard to crack passwords, and since they're really hard to crack, they said, okay, so we don't need the policy, we don't need fast renewal. People have chosen by themselves, really, really strong passwords. So we should continue like this. And I think this is a good idea, and this might be interesting to do in some companies in the future. So do's and don'ts. Do, answer questions to help the understanding process. Most people have questions when they come to awareness talks, when they come to see this kind of talks. They have questions like, hey, how are the passwords stored on the website? And why are they stored like this? How do we authenticate with passwords? How does it work? How are attackers working? What do they do? How can I be somewhat secure? And one question I have all the time, I want to secure myself against NSA. What can I do? Well, try to answer the questions, but don't forget that some people might be really paranoid. And want to protect themselves against the NSA and want to have a 20 characters long password and want to feel bulletproof. But tell them that if you block this access, the attacker will get the backdoor. So show them the real issues and involve users. This is something I do at every awareness talk I do, and I've had great feedbacks on this. So I show a list of passwords to the people, and I ask them about the security of the 4 or 5 passwords I put on screen. There is some kind of debate. We talk with each other, we make some votes, like, yeah, I think this password is safer than this one, etc. And in fact, the thing they don't know at the start is that they can't be all cracked in minutes because I only took this password from a random public word list. So when I tell them that all these passwords are just passwords that are in word list, public word list that are used every time by attackers, they're a bit shocked. And this is really interesting to show them the issue of password reuse, because you might think that a password is secure, you might think that it can be good, but as soon as it is reused and it is present in a data leak somewhere or in a word list, it can be cracked. And yeah, I've got very good feedback on this one because it really involves the people in your talks. The second issue is that really easy passwords might be avoided. To code dash line study. 31% have used their pet's name as a password. 23% have used number sequences, family member names, or birthday. And those are some things we can easily find nowadays using Google, Facebook, or Twitter about people. And they are putting themselves at risk by doing that. Maybe because some family member will try to get into their account, but most importantly, because those are also things that are shared by many people. Your pet's name, everyone has a dog or a cat somewhere, and I don't think the name you've given to your dog is unique in the world. Number sequences, yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Family member's name, John Jane Doe or Smith. Birthday, well, it's more evenly distributed. But if your neighbor can guess your password, it's bad. And this is just a simple rule. If your neighbor can guess your password because it relates to your personal data that is public, it's bad. And this has those two issues, password reuse and really weak passwords, as a real issues for 90% of people. We don't have to brag about very long passwords or bulletproof security. If you can do this, if you can show those real issues, it will be really important for most of them. So give them simple solution. Use password managers. Use Dashlane. Use 1Password. Use Lastlane. Use KeePass. Yes, there is an issue regarding online and offline managers. If you want to keep your data for yourself, or if you want to use it on the cloud to share it across your devices, well, for a user, if he can share his password across his devices, it's good, it's simpler for him. But as long as he uses a password manager and it can simplify his life, it's good. He would make a great leap for his password security. One thing important to note, I've already asked this question in France, certifications. KeePass, one old version of KeePass was certified by the French National Agency for Security, and they had to have this certification to be used in some companies. So show them the good sides of password manager. You don't have to memorize every password, you just have to memorize your master password. Uniqueness can be guaranteed if you use your password manager in a good way. It can be shared across your devices. It can simplify their lives. And also show them, have they been pwned yet, or other leak awareness websites, because they are really useful with the password manager. Do give figures and sources. NIST-DWARF guidelines and authentication security is really good. I really want to tell you to read this paper because it's really, really good. The guy behind passwordresearch.com is really doing very good work and gathering statistics, studies about passwords. I really want to thank to him, by the way.
Well, he has been watching earlier. He's
okay.
Yeah.
We'll have to tell him. one thing that was funny also, exhaustive brute force time for a given chipset length on a small GPU. For instance, during one awareness talk, when I gave some figures about exhaustive brute force time for some characters long passwords, I had actually one guy in the audience who was like this. So, okay, 7 characters long password, no. Bad idea. Do not forget reality. Most people have really simple passwords. When you launch some word list on data leaks and you gather 10 or 20 or 30% of the passwords in a few minutes just with simple mangling rules and simple word list, you know something is wrong, but you know something is also, this is something that is happening nearly every time. Most people have really simple passwords. Password use is quite high. You said 27%, but maybe with more data, I think it will be even higher. Even known people fail. Zuckerberg's password in LinkedIn was da-da-da. Da-da-da, please. he used it on Twitter also, Pinterest. Everyone fails. Do not use too much math. Really don't. You will lose your adherence. when I see exponential quirking time or high entropy password, most people will just disconnect their brain when they will see this. Prefer simple or human metrics like time, length, patterns, or anything that can be easily visualized. And avoid double entries, graphics. Do not brag. This is really important. Do not show last 5% passwords you have cracked. Do not say it was easy to crack a password when you have actually spent 10 hours cracking it. This is something I've seen in RNS talks. They've put some example passwords, and they've put passwords like this with high complexity, and they said, we crack this kind of password every day, you know. When I went out of this talk, I talked with other people who were present, and they all told me, do you want to be secure when you see that they can crack everything? Yeah. So don't brag. Don't brag, just don't. People will resign because everything will be cracked otherwise. And you have to put the idea that a good defense results in cost for an attacker. This is always the essence of it. The longer an attacker will have to run his GPU, the higher will be the cost will be for him. And you want to increase the cost for the attacker the most. Do not overstate something 14 characters long. Sorry. 14 characters long random password with all char sets present in it will be hard to crack if hashed, but it's not bulletproof. Snowden will have compromised computer. If you have virus on your computer, your password is dead. Snowden, NSA, they will bypass this. It's not a problem. In fact, bad information can have serious issues in real life. You really see that if you say something that might be a bad information for someone, there is a risk for this person. So you just don't want to overstate something. You want to make people aware of the real issues. So in a nutshell, 1 minute, yeah. Everyone has a responsibility. Users, developers, IT guys, CISO, researcher, everyone. User security is quite low, and small improvements are really welcomed. We don't want users to have very long passwords everywhere. We want them to be secure, at least for their emails and their bank accounts. Good awareness talks are really important. Rule number one, don't reuse passwords. And rule number two, don't use passwords that your neighbor can guess. This is just, for me, the two most important words. And helping people secure their email banking access is really a huge victory. Even, as I said, small improvements are really, really welcomed. And final conclusion, we all here have a responsibility. We must help people and not bury them with really technical talks. Just have simple talks with them and see how we can improve their security. Password Manager can really ease John and Jane Doe's life, really. And I want to thank the few people here who works for Password Manager. You are really doing great work. And this will ease their life and improve their online and offline security. And one thing I want to open on, terminology issue. This was actually a feedback I had in one of my talks. Passwords versus passphrase. We all talk about passwords every time. Well, apart from Per, but we all talk about passwords. Everywhere it's written passwords. When you sign in or register, it's written passwords. What if we change this and write passphrase? When I was young, when I generated my first SSH key, it was written, enter your passphrase. And I was like, oh my god, it's so secure. They want a passphrase and not a password. And I just entered the passphrase. And I was not knowing it was really more secure than the password at this time. So there might be something we can do here just by changing the terminology. And maybe we can do passphrases to 17 next year here. So thank you. And I hope you have enjoyed this talk.